In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together, along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. People have often wondered what this means, to deliver someone over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. This is not the only place the Bible refers to doing that kind of a thing. Paul says in 1 Timothy chapter 1 that he had done that very thing with Hymenaeus and Alexander, a couple of heretics, apparently, who had been in the church. It says in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 19 and 20, having faith and a good conscience, which some, having rejected concerning the faith, have suffered shipwreck, of whom are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. That's another case where someone's delivered to Satan. This man in Corinth and now Hymenaeus and Alexander both are cases where we read Paul sees them as to be delivered to Satan. Here the church is supposed to do it to this man. Paul did it himself to the other two guys, Hymenaeus and Alexander. I guess the question is, what does that mean? Well, bottom line is it means kick him out of the church. That's clear from what he says in verse 2, that you should have had this one who has done this evil deed should be taken from among you. And also in verse 13, put that away from yourselves, that wicked person. Or another place he says you need to purge out the leaven out of the church. What he's talking about when he talks about delivering someone to Satan is putting him out of the church, kicking him out, not fellowshipping with them. Now, why is this described as delivering them over to Satan? The assumption seems to be that as long as a person is in fellowship in the church, in good standing, a communicant at the Lord's table, participant in the love feasts, and accepted as one of the brethren, that person has spiritual protection from Satan, to a degree that they would not possess if they were not in the church. Satan is malicious and hostile, wants to hurt people. And not just Christians, he's just against everybody. He wants to rob, kill, and destroy. That's what he's into. But when a person comes into the protective fellowship of the saints, there's a degree of immunity that is gained from satanic attacks. Now, this doesn't mean you don't experience any temptation. It doesn't mean you don't experience any trials when you're in the church. But there is certainly a degree of protection there from the worst things that Satan could do to you if you were not protected in the church, or to be involved in a network of Christians who are keeping you accountable, who are praying for you, who are encouraging you on a regular basis. This is what fellowship affords us, and all of those things are safeguards against many of the things the devil would like to do to us. And in addition to those natural things, and we can see how people praying for me, people encouraging me, people keeping me accountable, all of those things would help me, for example, to escape temptations that I might not escape if I didn't have the support of a Christian community. But there's also something more mystical there, apparently. There's a sense in which you are, if you're in the fellowship of the saints, there is a protective covering that Satan cannot destroy your flesh in the way that Paul indicates will happen to a person if he's delivered over to Satan and is put out of the church, taken out of that protective custody of the church, and delivered over into a totally vulnerable position where Satan can destroy him, his flesh. And it sounds like an awfully mean and unloving thing to do, to deliver someone over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. But notice Paul says, so that his spirit will be saved in the day of Jesus Christ. So Paul obviously has this man's spiritual good in mind. The idea I understand to mean, put the guy out of the church, let the devil beat him up a little bit, and the guy come running home in repentance. Come running back to the church when he realizes he can't have the world and the church both. You can't have your sinful lifestyle and salvation too. And this is the reason it's so important, one of the reasons it's so important, to exercise this kind of a church discipline and not allow unrepentant sinners to stay in the church. Because it communicates the wrong message to them, it gives them a false assurance, and it also communicates the wrong message in general to the other Christians. And that is that you can have Jesus and sin. You can have your sinful lifestyle all you want and still be saved. That's not a true message. It gives people a false assurance. Now, the idea of putting people out of the church is from Jesus himself. He came up with it. And therefore, Paul's not originating something that is harsher than what Jesus would do. Some people think that Paul was harder, that in some ways he brought more ecclesiastical authoritarianism into the church than Jesus ever intended there to be. However, in Matthew 18, Jesus certainly taught what must be the basis for what Paul was saying here. Matthew 18, from verse 15 on, says, "Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you've gained your brother. But if he will not hear you, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen or a tax collector." Now, we're talking initially about a person who's regarded as a brother. At the beginning of this sequence, the guy is a brother. He sins. You approach him about it. You confront him. You got to repent. He repents. End of story. He doesn't repent. You bring more witnesses. If he repents then, end of story. But if he doesn't repent then, you make it a public matter. And if he doesn't repent then, you put him out of the church. Jesus doesn't say put him out of the church, but he says let him be to you like a heathen or a tax collector. In other words, a person that you shun. A person that you do not consider a brother. A person who is not regarded as having access to the privileges of church membership. And that would be like a splash of cold water in the face. Whoa, you know, I'm going to have to make a choice here between my sin and my salvation. And that's what Paul is saying you've got to do. If you do this and deliver this man over to Satan, for let the devil beat his flesh up a little bit, this at least potentially can result in his spirit being saved in the day of Christ. It's not the destruction of his flesh that causes his spirit to be saved. It's rather that the suffering he endures outside the church causes him to repent so that this results in his spirit being saved. That's how I understand it, and I think that's how most would understand this particular expression.